Hello and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio. This is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Today we have a special guest, blown for good himself, Marc Headley. Marc, welcome to the show.
Well, thanks for having me.
Marc, I want to get right into it. David Miscavige likes big events, big flashy events where he raises money. What does it take to produce a David Miscavige event, and how many are there?
Well, before I say anything, I just want to make sure people know that I worked at the international headquarters of Scientology for 15 years. So from 1990 to 2005, I was stationed in their secret headquarters in Gilman Hot Springs, California. And for most of that 15 years, I was over the video and film production, as well as the design and production of the audiovisual systems that were installed in Scientology facilities all over the world. So bookstore systems, digital film rooms, all those automated video displays they have in all the Scientology organizations. I designed all of those, and I was either part of the event crew or I oversaw the budgets for events for a lot of those 15 years that I was there. So I could tell you all about the events off the top of my head without any problems whatsoever. So they had seven events, major events, that would occur no matter what every year. And those events would have anywhere from 2,000 to 3,000 people show up at the actual event location. And then a lot of times they'd either have a delayed broadcast the next day or that weekend, or they'd have local events that would play, that would be like video playouts in the individual Scientology organizations around the world. And on pretty much for the 15 years that I was there, we rarely saw an event that had an overall attendance, the live event and all the you know, the subsequent week events. We rarely had the attendance over 10,000 people. That would be the target figure to hit would be 10,000 people.
You know, that's an interesting number. Lady Bird, God rest her soul, was a critic on Xenu.net, former Sea Org member Lori Kunius, that was her real name. She said there were 10,000 silver-certed e-meters in existence. That's about a 2004-2005 number. 10,000 has been a number used here and there to say that's, you know, the real number of active Scientologists in the world. Do you think that's a good number?
I think it's a very good number, because if you're beating the phones for weeks and weeks and weeks leading up to an event, and worldwide you can get 10,000 people to show up, then those are – I mean, some of those are staff, some of those are Sea Org members, and then, you know, you're saying that's amount of silver-certed e-meters. Well, I know for a fact when I was at Golden Era Productions, there were no more than 30,000 Mark Super 7 Quantum, whatever you want to call it, there were no more than 30,000 of those that were ever made. So it's – and even then, if you had – everybody is supposed to have two, and then you count all the ones that are still in stock and then the ones that are out of use, that 10,000 figure, it kind of – it washes out at 10,000 kind of no matter which path you take as a solid number. And then you could say, well, maybe that's 20,000. Well, sure, there's probably another – for each person that's still going to an event and everything, there's probably another person that's maybe involved or, you know, still calls himself one but doesn't really show up or do anything. But when you get past 20, 30,000, then I consider that just an unreality. I don't think you could ever – you know, round those guys up. If push came to shove, I don't think anybody'd be able to round up 30,000 quote unquote Scientologists.
No, I quite agree with you. And in fact, it's interesting that one of the central metrics of the Church of Scientology International is to put 10,000 people on solo nuts. So that might really be the upper threshold of, you know, the amount of people they think they could get onto solo nuts, which is, you know, the top of the bridge at or near OT7. So in these events, the purpose, as I understood, they began as ways, a way David Miscavige had to communicate to the field.
Yeah, well, it's sort of a double-pronged sort of thing. So, well, first of all, for those people, there's some trains of thought that, you know, David Miscavige is this evil guy, and L. Ron Hubbard, you know, wasn't so bad, and he had some stuff that was workable. But when he left, then David Miscavige sort of ruined the whole thing. Well, just to start off, L. Ron Hubbard clearly stated that these sort of events that David Miscavige does, he's clearly stated that these are forbidden. There's under no circumstances should you hold events, should you round everybody up. He even said that it was bad for the organizations to have these events. So that's one thing. And then separately, L. Ron Hubbard also sort of frowned upon and stated in policy that fundraising was also a forbidden tactic that the organizations should partake in. So, and that's sort of what these events are. It's a chance for David Miscavige to sort of tell everybody what he's been up to, what he's done, and then the culmination of that is here's this thing that is now being released, and now you need to buy it. So it's that 1-2 punch of this is what we did, these are all the things we're up to, and now based on that, look what you need to buy. And at the international headquarters, that was sort of the barometer on if it was going to be a good event or a bad event. If there was an event that was coming up and there was nothing to release at the event, there was no product that could be sold at the event, it was going to be a bad event because it's sort of you're spending all this money to put on this convention, so to speak, but there's nothing to sell. There's nothing that's going to come of it. We're going to spend the money to put it on, but there's no return whatsoever. So let me just take you through the events that take place throughout each year, and then we'll sort of touch upon, you know, what gets done at each event, because they do have a sort of pattern that they try to stick to, or that when I was there, the last I was there was in 2005. So obviously, you know, almost a decade's gone past, but they sort of still stick to this pattern, and this was laid out and sort of devised by David Miscavige. So the first event you have is the New Year's event, and that's celebrating the, you know, the imaginary international expansion that's taking place throughout the year. And and a lot of times this is where you get these made up statistics and stories, and, you know, it's all these exploding graphics of all the, you know, how Scientology's taking over the entire universe.
Mark, let me interject here. You make a great point. I was at the 2007 New Year's Eve event, and in my experience, because I worked with statistics for my entire career in business, my opinion is that David Miscavige does not present statistics. What he presents are icons,
yeah,
actual representations of alleged numbers.
Yeah.
And they're meaningless, and they go by so fast on the screen that you really can't read them.
Yeah, it's well, you know, you say that there, the one of the specialties that they have, and you'll notice this if you get a hold of one of these videos, or if you see even in hard copy written publications, they'll say, you know, like the number, we could say a student completion is a statistic. So a person goes into a Scientology organization and they do a Scientology course, and when they complete that course, it's called a student completion. So maybe last year they had 5 student completions. So this year they'll have 10 student completions, which is just minuscule. You know, one tiny Scientology mission should be capable of completing 10 student completions in a week. In a week would be a slow week if they did 10. But let's say for this argument, we'll say they did 10 in the whole year. So because they had 5 last year, they could say they did 10 this year. And so they'll have this graphic where they say we've, you know, we 2X'd the number of student completions throughout this year. And you're like, well, yeah, you only did 5 last year. So doing 10 this year is, you know, that's like, you know, one person on their own could do that. And that sort of carries throughout all of the statistics. And they have systems where they – and this is very, very specific to the New Year's event, because they, you know, they'll say – it has this international expansion theme. So they'll say the number of student completion check sheets, you know, stacked end to end would reach the Eiffel Tower. You know, that's like,
oh,
that's,
yeah,
like 3
that, yeah,
check sheets. You know, so it's like, okay, like that's 3 completions. So it's sort of kind of, you know, the number of success stories would reach the moon and back. And, you know, they have all these things that they kind of convert things to. Instead of saying, you know, last year we had 50 completions and this year we had 10. So you can't say we had 10, but if you kind of convert that 10 number of course pack individual pages stacked end to end, single sided, you know, it's just like, okay.
Reach the moon,
yeah,
and back.
Yeah, reach the moon and back, and you go, well, yeah, that's, you know, that's like 15. And then it sort of gets creative, because then you go, well, let's not just include the check sheet, let's include the course pack. And, well, we can include the lecture transcripts. And you're talking about hundreds and hundreds and maybe thousands of pages of text. And so it adds up very quickly. You could – an Eiffel Tower stat is just – it's a no-brainer. It's like, oh, yeah, we can make an Eiffel – we can reach an Eiffel Tower pretty much no matter how we do it. So
okay.
Anyway, so that's New Year's. And usually at New Year's, they would release a tape series that had, you know, been resurrected from the depths of a bad recording that was overseen by the master audio recording engineer L Ron Hubbard. And they had figured out some way to restore that, and then, you know, they'll sell that at the event, and that'll be the New Year's event release.
Yeah, and I wanted to add here that the usual testimonial from gushing church members is that it feels like I'm right in the room with L. Ron Hubbard.
Yeah, that's
– and, well, like, if you listen to any recording, you could be in the room with you could be right in the room with Richard Nixon, with Bill Clinton. I mean,
yeah.
it doesn't mean anything. You're right in the room with him.
Yeah, and so. Especially in this day and age, it's almost laughable that this man was this master recording engineer. Then why is there an entire organization and departments and divisions dedicated to fixing these recordings that he did that were just 100% horrible? It's amazing that they can do that because they were that bad. But at the same time, it's like, well, if that's the guy who – he invented the technology to restore the lectures that he recorded horribly. So it's sort of like, okay.
Okay. Good point.
Anyway, the next event is the March 13th event, and that's a celebration of the anniversary of L. Ron Hubbard's birthday. And usually some Hubbard PR publication or magazine will get released – that everyone's obligated to purchase, and then purchase a bunch more for libraries that never end up in any of those places. And then you have in May, on May 9th, you have the May 9th event. And that's a celebration of the anniversary of the publication of the book Dianetics. Now, usually Dianetics-themed events and a Dianetics product will be released that'll no doubt get Dianetics being used by every man, woman, and child in the universe tomorrow. And every year they'd have this release, and it was basically like, okay, that's it. This year, Dianetics is going to be, you know, on the tip of everyone's tongue because of this release. And that's included everything from Dianetics, new Dianetics books, books with holographic volcanoes, a trade paperback release, a Dianetics infomercial, Dianetics how-to videos, a $100 kit that has all those things in it. A 1-800 line for people trying to figure out how to audit Dianetics. They can call into that. TV ads. I mean, the list goes on forever. And every year, this is it. With this new thing that we just figured out, this marketing, you know, brainchild that's just going to blow the doors off of Dianetics gets released at the May 9th event. And usually they'll show some video of people auditing Dianetics and how, you know, the whole of Memphis is now going to be cleared in the next year because we've got 17 people, you know, that are co-auditing or, you know, whatever it is.
Yeah, it's entire continents.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the best thing is if you go and look back at any of these events, it's sort of like, oh, yeah, it's taped. We've got it. And that's the way every single event is. So depending on the theme, it's like, this is it, folks. It's all downhill from here. And it's been that way since the very first event I worked on in 1990. And it has been downhill, but not the way they wanted it to be.
Yeah.
Okay, so then after May 9th, you have June 6th. Now, June 6th is an interesting beast because it's the anniversary of the maiden voyage of the Sea Org motor vessel Freewinds. And this cruise ship, quote-unquote, I mean, it's the tiniest cruise ship you'll ever see. When it's docked next to one of these Princess or Norwegian, it looks like the tug that's going to bring that thing back out from the dock. It's that small compared to it. But that's the ship, that's the delivery location for their OT8. That's the highest processing level that you can do in Scientology. That's the only place you can do it is out on this boat in the middle of the Caribbean. Anyway, but so it's very small, and I think it fits the Starlight Cabaret is the venue where these events are hosted. Maybe holds 200 people, you know, maybe. That's the maximum it holds. It's very tiny. So they round up all of the top, really I want to say whales in Scientology. And that's where they're going to wine them and dine them and tell them how they're awesome and everything that has happened throughout the past year was really spearheaded and run by them. They have these OT committees, and it's really OT7s that are auditing. They're currently auditing on OT7s that have big bucks, and then your OT8, people who've completed OT8 or they're in the middle of doing OT8. And that's the audience. And they want some people that are doing OT8 because during the week they're going to try and milk as much as they can to maybe each night say, hey, you know, Billy Bob completed OT8. Let's, you know, give him a round of applause. And then he can say, this is the most amazing thing. And then they can use that to sort of leverage these other OT7s or anybody else who there hasn't paid for their accommodations and their OT8. How much ever it costs to do that level, they can sort of say, hey, it's time to fork over some dosh for your OTA as long as you're here.
Certainly an impressive thing about having your own private motor vessel is no one can escape the regs. You're on the boat out in the middle of the ocean.
Yeah, and that's kind of how this event, it also takes on this special uniqueness is that it's a week-long event. So every night there's an event, and it sort of gives an opportunity for all these front groups that are involved in Scientology that don't really fit into any of the other events throughout the year. Well, they kind of get showcased in this June 6th anniversary series of events. So you have all the front groups. So like you have ABLE, there's an ABLE night, and the ABLE night event would include Narconon, Applied Scholastics, The Way to Happiness, or Criminon. So if there's anything they can kind of scratch up or dig up on any of those guys, they can put a video together, and that'll be featured on the ABLE night. And then that gives them a chance to kind of hit these people up for donations to ABLE to forward whatever, you know, Narconon, Applied Scholastics, Way to Happiness, or Criminon programs. They can sort of lump together and they can get some money out of them for that. So that's one night. Then you might have an ASI / CST night, and that's authored services, which is the group or the Sea Org organization that manages the royalties for L. Ron Hubbard for all the fiction and nonfiction books that he's written, all the money that's generated from them, that's managed and handled by ASI. And their sister org is an organization called Church of Spiritual Technology, that's CST. And they're the ones that are responsible for spending all that money that ASI makes. So they are the ones that are taking all Hubbard's writings and burning them or etching them onto silver, gold, or titanium, or whatever the precious metal of the month is. That's what they're burning those writings to. And they spend millions and millions of dollars, and they're the ones with all the underground vaults and, you know, secret logos etched into mountainsides or, you know, New Mexico deserts. And these two organizations are like David Miscavige's little pet projects. So he kind of – they're not part of the Scientology command structure. They're kind of off to the side next to RTC. And the only line that goes to those is from RTC. So they don't report to anybody else, and they don't answer really to anybody else. And they kind of have their own they're just off to the side on the command structure of Scientology.
Sure. And this raises an interesting question to interject. The Church of Spiritual Technology, the 2012 book value is $447 million. And that's, you know, the author's royalties. This is something I've never understood. I'm going to write about it on my blog, ScientologyMoneyProject.com. A big deal is made in the Church of Scientology that L. Ron Hubbard bequeathed his cash and his copyrights to the church. So all of his intellectual property, the technology, they call it, copyrights, trademarks, has been bequeathed. And they make a big deal out of this. But if it's a gift, why must royalties be collected on it by RTC, CST? Why do you need to collect royalties if it was a gift? Why are they still getting paid? That I don't understand. That's a question. Maybe another show we can talk about CST, because it's really interesting, the technology of recording the scriptures of the church and then burying them in vaults. The second question I have, Mark, on the maiden voyage event, you mentioned that a lot of the whales were there, the big rollers, the big money people. Is this a week on the ship where you get FaceTime with David Miscavige? You get to rub elbows with him?
Depends on how much money you fork over. So that's sort of how it works. If you're going to give, you know, if you're Nancy Cartwright and you give Dave $10 million, then you're getting a picture in the magazine with David Miscavige and, you know, some sort of trophy or this or that or the other thing. But and then they have sort of their people that are kind of like every year that person's going to fork over some dough. So like the Craig Jensens, the Baybacks, there's sort of this Scientology elite that, you know, have money to burn, and they show up and they – you know, they give them a few million, and then, you know, David Miscavige will give them an award, or give their business a, you know, an ideal management organization, or, you know, whatever the lingo they use for these things. But it is definitely, if you're going to meet the dude and you're going to get your picture with him, this is your big chance.
So you better have a big check to get a picture with COB.
You're not getting in there. You're not getting into a picture with him unless you forked over some dough. That there's no way around that part.
Understood.
So and that's sort of we're up to like that's ASI CST night. So next you could do like a wise night, and like that's where they'd give out one of these sort of management awards for all these. You know, WISE is it's sort of the organization that originally it was supposed to make it so Scientology organizations wouldn't prey upon the organizations and their staff. So, you know, let's say there's a Scientology company that sells toy airplane gliders. They don't want that toy airplane glider company going to the org and saying, hey, we're a Scientology company. Why don't you guys come work with us at night, and we'll pay you twice as much as you make during the day at the org. So they set up this organization that they say, well, you have to pay us a percentage to use our management technology. But then these are all these rules that you have to follow. And then it also – has another purpose where if you're a Scientology company and you get into a spat with a Scientologist or another Scientology company, they kind of keep it within themselves, and they don't go to the local authorities. They try to keep it out of the courts, and is sort of this arbitration thing, which is really whatever's good for Scientology is going to be the way that arbitration is going to go down. And as long as we can keep it out of, you know, off the radar in terms of, you know, law enforcement and, you know, the court system. Well, they'll have a night where they'll show how some company, some wise companies, you know, doing awesome and making gazillions of dollars and getting Scientology into the business world, whether chiropractors or dentists or, you know, whatever. Then they'll have an IAS patrons ball night. Now, this is the one where whatever happened up until now, this is sort of like the night, the last night of the week. And this is anybody who hasn't given all week long, this is it. Because this is where you have the Nancy Cartwrights or the big time whales getting hit up for tens of millions of dollars in donations, and the chance for them to upgrade their status to the next, you know, patron meritorious maximus glutimus, you know, boom, you know, this is it. This is where you're going to do it. And because you're with all those other guys, now you're kind of in now in that crowd, if you weren't already.
Oh, sure. There's a lot of pressure to donate, increase your status. So the IES Patrons Ball, that's like that is the big money night.
Yeah, and this is now at the free wins. So this used to be there used to only be two IES events a year. There'd be an IES night at the ship, and then there'd be an IES event in England. And they sort of – I think they just made so much money on those events, they just started having them whenever, wherever. You know, if there's a – you know, farmer's market opened up last week, sure, let's follow it with an IS patrons ball, you know, and then they'll have one in Glendale. You know, it's just like, okay, now they're just doing them so they can make some more money. There's no kind of rhyme or reason to when or how they happen other than those two – sort of designated time periods. So
no, and you make a good point, because the Church of Scientology collectively it doesn't really need an excuse to raise money. It's inherently a fundraising machine that's out of control. And something I notice is that yes, the IES raises money, any kind of pretext it can use. Alternately, the church also raises money when any disaster happens, when a celebrity dies.
Absolutely.
They raise money.
Yeah.
And I make a joke with Karen, someone's dead, give us money. That's the church's approach. When Whitney Houston died, they used it to raise money. And when there's an earthquake, disaster, fire, terrorist attack, school shooting, they're raising money.
Yeah. Well, you had mentioned before on that CST thing, like why are they collecting money if the royalties were gifted? And I guarantee you, Scientology's answer to that is why not? It's not a matter of why. It's why wouldn't we? You know, we can, so we might as well. You know.
Point well taken, indeed.
Okay, so that's June 6th. So we're only halfway through the year, and that's four quote unquote events. But then that June 6th event was really five nights of events. So that's halfway. Now the fifth event is the Celebrity Center International Gala. And that didn't really used to be a major event. It was sort of like, okay, we're going to have it was really like a garden party. And then, you know, they'd throw in the Elena Ruggiero or Dougie Fresh or Isaac would, you know, play some songs with the Golden Era musicians, and that would be it. I think in the early 2000s, David Miscavige sort of was like, you know, this is sort of a chance where I can have, you know, he can have his big Hollywood shoulder rubbing orgasm opportunity. So he spoke at the event, and it's been his gig ever since. So now it's a major event that has a stage, and it has a, you know, a presentation by him or a speech and all sorts of celebrity kind of themed yip-yap happens at that event. And there's there wasn't really anything that could be sold at that. And then they had a DVD that they released from that event. And then they started kind of, you know, selling extension courses or booklets or that. I'm always trying to figure out something they can kind of squeeze in there that can be like, hey, we, you know, we're doing this. Let's make some money. So,
Mark, you know what's very funny is I did a post on Xenu.net, and this is kind of funny, but and going back to statistics, anyone can use Google. You type in Scientology 1400, and every PR web release for the Celebrity Center International Gala, it'll always say more than 1,400 attend the Church of Scientology Celebrity Center Gala, but 1,400 is a recurrent number for small events.
Yeah.
And when I did so 1,400 is a solid number because no one's going to question 1,400. It's believable. And then at the opening of Ideal Orgs, and we're jumping ahead a little bit, they tend to like numbers of 2,500, 5,000, or more than 10,000. Back to Celebrity Center, does it fit 1,400? Could you put that many people at CCI?
No, like I said, it's sort of like a garden event. So it's a table event. So there's not a real audience seating. It's not festival seating or audience seating. It's tables that people are eating, and you know, it's 8 or 10 to a table, and there's X amount of tables. There's probably 150 tables. And they fit 10 people each. That's 1,500 people.
Okay, so
they probably have a few people that don't show up, but they say so it was over 1,400, but they know it wasn't over 1,500 because it only fits 1,500. The maximum, or the fire marshal amount is 1,500. So they don't want to say we had over 1,500 people there because that's illegal. So you know, but even still, this is really the part that blows my mind is when the Scientologists say they have. You know, I don't remember who the last person to say it, but probably Kirstie Alley or one of these muckety mucks said they had over 20 million or 25 million members, and even Scientology's own spokesholes will say tens of millions, and you just go like, okay, so 1,500 showed up for this gig, or even these international, the biggest event in Scientology's history is happening. It's going to be the New Year's event. Or, you know, every event they have is going to be the watershed moment of Scientology's entire history. And, you know, 3,000 people showed up. It's like, well, how is that possible? You know, if you had a Jedi convention, 100,000 kids would show up. You know, or regular people, adults, kids.
Undoubtedly.
100,000 would show up. And so you sort of go like, well, and those people are paying. These are free events to get in free. You get out. That's a whole other story. But so that's Celebrity Center International Gala. So number six is the Auditor's Day event. And, you know, for those who aren't, you know, versed in all the lingo, the auditor is the counselor, Scientology counselor. So it's sort of the event that celebrates auditing, Scientology counseling. And that comes in late September. It used to be that if there was nothing to release for this event, because we either shot our wad for the year already or everyone was just too tired to get anything done by this point in the year, the event would be held in Clearwater at the Fort Harrison Hotel. In the Scientology Hotel there in Clearwater, and they would fly in some talking heads to give out some Auditor of the Year awards to the local flag auditors. Now, if we did have something to release, like some new auditor courses or Golden Age of Robo Eyes or whatever the latest thing is that they're going to come out with, then it could be a Shrine Auditorium event or maybe Ruth Eckerd Hall, which is a small auditorium in Florida that's near Clearwater. And that's where, you know, it really, I think it was just which way the wind was blowing, or if Dave wanted to hang out in Florida instead of Los Angeles, then they'd have it at Ruth Eckerd Hall instead of the Shrine Auditorium.
But it's not a big event. As Auditor's Day has become...
It's sort of like, unless there's a new auditor, some new auditor training or new auditor course or some technical release, then Auditor's Day is kind of like, I'm pretty sure that's where all these golden age events, they always kind of hatch on an Auditor's Day. And that's because it's really the only one that fits that sort of theme, technical theme, because that's the counseling, that's the celebration of the auditor event. So that's, you know, And like I said, sometimes there just weren't Auditor's Day events. Or they would just be at flag, and then it would be like, yeah, there's no delayed replay. Just have your hold your own event and give your top auditor, you know, a trophy and pat him on the back and tell him to get back to work. So that's kind of – if there's going to be a throwaway event, that's the one that gets thrown away. And we're going to have to bust our asses to make something, make a release or make a deadline for that event – then David Miscavige will just be like, well, you guys are going to screw it up. You're not going to make it, so we'll just hold it till New Year's, or we'll hold it till the next Auditor's Day. We won't even bother with it. We'll just save it. And so – and that's another thing that's kind of – when you're there behind the scenes, it's sort of like, here's this technical release or this product that's been developed or unearthed by David Miscavige through all the, you know, faulty semicolons and periods. And it's sort of pitched as this is gonna revolutionize Scientology. We've been hanging on to it at the international headquarters for 3 or 4 years because of some reason or other. And now it's done. So we're going to give it to you. But to you, the Scientology member, we're going to tell you that it's the most important thing that you've ever laid your eyes on.
So, yeah, and
it's all PR. It's all marketing. It's all just if you only knew that this is a tiny, tiny microcosm of all the stuff that's going on over there.
So what happens after Auditor's Day? Next event.
The next event after Auditor's Day is the IAS event. Now, this is the International Association of Scientologists, and this is the anniversary of the founding of that association. In the 80s and the early 90s, it sort of used to kind of go wherever. We had them in LA, we had one in Copenhagen, I think there was one in Spain. They were all kind of all over. And then at a certain point, David Miscavige realized that he wasn't able to sort of flog these European Scientology members that much because we weren't going there. So it was decided that every year the IAS event is going to be in the United Kingdom in East Grinstead, where they have this, you know, castle at
St. Hill.
Yeah, St. Hill, the United Kingdom's, you know, Sea Org base, this property they have there. And then that was the chance, the one-time chance for the year where you could sort of get all the European people to fly into England and we can get that – we could, you know, hit them up for some cash, and because that's where they're going to go do services, and that's sort of like their, you know, their place that we're going to go to. And that event is the one event of the year that's 100% funded by the IAS. So all the other events that we talk about, that we've talked about, those are all paid for by the International Scientology Finance Office in CMO International, which is the Commodore's Messenger Organization International. And that's where all the Scientology money funnels up to from all the organizations. It all kind of goes to the International Finance Office of Scientology.
Okay.
And that's where all these events are paid for, except for this one IAS event is paid for completely by the IAS. And it was always a very specific figure that we had for our budget. And it was very, very closely monitored by the IAS. And it was sort of the one event where there was no budget mistakes or no funny stuff could go on this event. This one, they're going to, you know, you say it's going to cost, you know, $500,000. We ain't spending more than $500,000. So, and they would usually have, and oddly enough, this was usually the most expensive event that would happen throughout the entire year. It would be this event because there would be 3 or 4 videos. Usually at least 2 or 3 of those videos would be in Russia or Spain or Mexico, or we'd have to fly a whole crew there for a month or so to shoot these IAS winner videos. And those would run, you know, anywhere from 20 to 40K each. And then there'd be travel for the entire crew and all of the hired professionals that would get flown to each event. The tent costs, which we used to rent that tent that they would set up next to the St. Hill Hall, or whatever it's called, the Great Hall. And it used to be that the event would take place in the Great Hall, which holds like a few hundred people. And then the event was – they're really trying to get these people for a lot of money. And it's like, well, we can't really cram them into this event hall if we're trying to get all this money out of them. Let's have the event in the tent and have the overflow be in the hall. And so they got this huge tent and they deck it out and just, you know, go balls to the walls on the decor and the meal and everything else. And then they could eat. They'd have a patron's ball the next night. And so then we have like another sitting event, and we kind of wine them and dine them and then hit them up for the donations for the IAS. So that's seven of these events that happen throughout the year, and that's sort of the rhyme or reason behind each one of them.
That is a couple notes I have. This is very valuable detail, because what you're describing, you know, to me as an outsider, a corporate guy, say this is a fundraising organization, as I mentioned earlier. One thing I want to tell our listeners they may not know, and I posted Jay Swift's illustrated guide to the Church of Scientology International recently on the Money Project blog. This is pretty astounding. You were a Sea Org member. Now, David Miscavige's attorney, Lamont Jefferson, just made it very clear in Texas that you as a Sea Org member belong to an unincorporated religious order.
That's exactly correct. The Sea Organization.
Yes, you have no legal standing. No address, no phone number. Now, the IAS, the International Association of Scientologists, a lot of people don't know it, but that also is an unincorporated association. The Church of Scientology told the IRS in 1993 that the Church of Scientology itself does not exist. There's no Church of Scientology. There's a Church of Scientology International, CST, RTC, etc. So you have IES members belonging to an unincorporated association, Sea Org members belonging to an unincorporated association. Mark, you cannot join the Church of Scientology. There's no possible way. The membership organization for Scientologists is the IES. And because it has no legal standing, it can't conduct business. So what it needs is something called the IAS Administrations Incorporated.
That's right.
And this gets very murky. So you have basically IAS members who are unincorporated associations, Sea Org members who are unincorporated religious order, coming together on property owned by the church for the purpose of raising money. And this gets really funny, because you have the church owning the property, but not having any members or employees.
Well, yeah, this is not an accident. It's all constructed this way. So believe me, I know, because I had a lawsuit against Scientology, and it's just smoke and mirrors. There's this guy over here did this, but he's not part of the same group that you're part of. And so you're not really under his authority. So if he told you to do something, then you didn't really have to do it. And it's literally sea lawyering to the nth degree. If you want to, you know, no mistake that it's a sea organization and they do all the sea lawyering.
I mean, that's well said, Mark. And what's interesting is you state that the IES event, you had to watch every penny. And this architecture of fundraising through these series of events, and oh, by the way, if you go to, Mark, if you go to the Scientology.org, they have a page called What Religious Holidays Do Scientology Celebrate?
Oh, really?
What Religious Holidays Do Scientologists Celebrate? and they go through the exact events you described. So
you
these are fundraisers, but the church calls them religious holidays.
Yeah, because that's what they're that's when they fundraise. It's a holiday for sure.
you can see that in that so-called Scientology religion, it's a high holy day.
Yeah, it's the money, the day of the money.
So it's just a series of you're really busting your ass to stage several events a year for the purpose of raising money and nothing else.
Absolutely. That's what I was saying. If there wasn't a product or there wasn't something that could be, you know, sold or quote unquote released at an event, then David Miscavige would just go, you know, he would go crazy on us, to put it lightly, because that's sort of, and then oftentimes he would save the day and dig something up or go, well, we could do this, and he'd figure out something to release if what we had planned or what he had originally laid out couldn't, you know, be made to happen, then he'd make something happen because, you know, this is it. You only get X amount of chances a year to make the bucks, the big bucks, the tens of millions. So, you know, it's going to happen. Something's going to happen. We're going to sell something.
Yeah, better dig something out of the vault. Now, one thing we were talking about before the show, Mark, some of the executives who spoke at the events would literally be in the SP hole. They would be in RPF.
Well, not the RPF, but they would be in some sort of, you know, in some sort of punishment mode for something that they'd done. I remember specifically when there was a time when we were assigned to the executives of the Scientology headquarters were assigned to clean out the sewage aeration pond. So this is a pond where all of the sewage from the property is pumped out to, and then it aerates. There's a pump and the water is circulated and the, you know, the sewage is aerated. And what they would do is it would aerate throughout the year, but then ever so often they would turn off the pump and turn off all the feeds to one pond, and they'd flip it over to the other pond. There's two of them, and they'd let one of them dry out. So you'd have the solid fecal matter would be just cakes or dried. It'd be like a football field of fecal matter. And then in this case, instead of just cleaning it out with heavy equipment like they normally did, I assume, because I'd never seen this happen in the whole time I was there. But this time they had – it was about maybe 100 or so of us. We were assigned to physically, manually clear it out. So we had buckets like, you know, that you get from the hardware store, and we were filling the buckets, scooping it into the fecal matter. We're standing in the fecal matter. We're scooping up the buckets and we're chaining them out. And we were doing this for days, but I remember – that somebody came, security guard and somebody, some other person came to the pond, and, you know, one of these executives was carted off, you know, one of these Mark Yeager, Guillaume or Mike Rinder, one of these cats were up. He's taking him off, and who knows what he's going to go do, but it was literally you get one of these guys and they got to go handle some legal case, or, you know, they need to go brief attorneys or whatever, and they're literally coming out of this pond of fecal matter and going off, getting cleaned up, putting a suit on, and then they're going and briefing the lawyers that David Miscavige has never punished anyone, you know. and you just go, like, you know, that you really have the brainwashing has really got to be solid for a person to take a timeout on his punishment to then go off and defend David Miscavige that he doesn't punish people. So it's just like – and I joked. I don't remember where it was. I might have posted something on an internet forum or something that Mike Rinder had he was – John Sweeney was like, are you sure David Miscavige never physically assaulted anybody? And I said that he was full of crap when he said that David Miscavige hadn't assaulted anybody. And then I was like, no, literally, he was full of crap. He had just come from the sewage pond when he had went off and told Sweeney that. But
Mark, that's astonishing. You know, if you for our listeners, if you're unfamiliar, you can put into Google Scientology Gold Base, look at the Google Earth picture. You'll see the actual ponds, the Aeration ponds at the Gold Base in Hemet, California. And this is a violation of law. You know, OSHA regulations don't permit people to work without respirators. You would use heavy equipment, like you said, to clean fecal matter out of these aeration ponds. Didn't people get sick? I mean, what was the fallout of having to work in a very dangerous condition?
Well, I know of at least two individuals that got ill. I think one of them even actually ended up going to the hospital, the emergency room. But, I mean, I don't know how long. It was at least a few days, maybe even a week. I was, you know, after very long showers, I would still have, you know, fecal matter coming out of, you know, ears and pores and eyes. And, you know, when you have brown, muddy tears, you know, you...
Well, you would reek. Yeah, the body's working to clean itself.
Well, yeah, because it's you're breathing it and you're working in it and it's dust. So it's dry. So, and it's in the middle of the desert. So you're scooping it, and it's just this cloud of fecal dust. It's just, and there's 100 people doing this. So whether or not you're making any dust or not, or you're trying to be careful, this, you're just in a cloud of it. So,
well, it's disgraceful. And anyone who's, I lived in the desert for a long time, I lived out in the Mojave Desert, and I'm a desert rat by nature. And there are days out in the desert where the wind is just driving. If you know, I've been out in the desert doing different things, and you are caked with dust in your sinuses, your ears, your eyes,
oh, yeah.
Skin, fingernails. So I can imagine the same condition applies there. But it does speak to David Miscavige's sadistic nature, because he could easily hire a company that specializes in this to just get it
done.
Oh,
yeah. No, it wasn't about the practicality of having us do it. It was purely... You know what? It's what they call in Scientology. It's called a too gruesome. So the threat of not getting a target done is a too gruesome. So there's no way you would ever want to clean out the aeration pond. So you're going to get this done. And he'd run out of quote unquote too gruesomes. So this was it. This was like, well, there's nothing worse than this. I mean, and they're really... I can think of little else that happened there that was worse than that. That was pretty hardcore. And it went on for days and days. It wasn't just like, you know, you go down there for an hour and everybody goes, okay, uncle, we give. We'll do whatever you want. No, it was day in and day out. We worked from early in the morning, and they had lights, big tower, generators and lights set up so we could go all night long. It was hardcore.
But what's stunning about this is, Mark, as you're describing fantasy versus reality, the fantasy are these events with these big, gaudy stage sets. You know, the phony gold columns, the podiums, the lights, and highest ever international expansion. Scientology will clear the planet. And yet the very people staging the events are having to clean out lakes full of dried sewage.
Oh, yeah. No, and that's sort of, this and many other things I detail in my book, but it's sort of like all these things where you're watching, you're seeing behind the curtain. So everyone else sees this, you know, oh, this is the almighty Miscavige. Well, you see behind the curtain, and you see everything that he says is a complete and utter 100% lie. And then you go like, well, what are we doing here? You know, he's telling everybody everything's wonderful. And this place that we're working is 100% Scientology. So it's essentially the utopia that Scientology will create if propagated to the whole planet. This is what it's going to be like everywhere, because this place is there already. There's nobody there that's not a Scientologist. Everybody working and living there, and the way it's run and the way the finances are and the management and the, you know, the
so there's your Scientology.
This is the utopia that Scientology is trying to attain. It's already set up. at this one place, and it is the biggest nightmare in the world. So then you kind of go like, well, you know, that's when you go, I got to get out of here, because I don't want to make everywhere else like this, because, you know, I'd rather die than to be here another day. So,
Mark, you work closely with David Miscavige, and what you're saying is correct. If you want a Scientology planet, a utopia, go to Gold Base, and you'll see the practical application of Scientology. David Miscavige assaulted you. What happened?
Well, it's sort of a long story, but to kind of condense it, I was over the production facility that made all of the compact discs and all of the audiovisual manufacturing products. And I was also I guess you'd call it an executive producer. And we had to get X amount of compact discs. This is hilarious, because it was for the basics. That's what it was for. It was for the golden age of tech and the basics. And we were going to release all of these lectures and all of these books without typos in them, because, you know, that's what
the evil semicolon.
That's what's holding these folks back, is, you know, they're cause over matter, energy, space, and time, but a semicolon, hey, so they are going to release all these compact discs. It was an exact amount. Like, we're going to release X amount of them, and they have to be released by this exact date. And so I was charged with figuring out the math for how to produce that amount of product in X amount of days. And I worked with the Church of Spiritual Technology folks, the CST folks, which are – they're sort of the experts on spending mass amounts of money, millions of dollars worth of money on equipment and stuff. So they were sort of side-checking and sort of double-checking my figures and my math and what equipment I was specifying and all this. And so then I came – we had my whole proposal that we spent weeks putting together, and we went to a meeting, and Dave Miscavige said, okay, what do you got? And it was like, okay, we need to get this equipment and that equipment. It was like, well, how much? I said, $5 million. And he freaking lit up like a Christmas tree. He went
wrong.
He was like, you just want to spend money, and this is all about the toys and blah, 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 blah. Anyway, I literally got escorted out of the meeting and put on an e-meter and interrogated. Like literally, I went from the meeting to be interrogated on an e-meter. And of course, the guy, Russ Bellin, who was the commanding officer of CST, he pleaded ignorance. He's like, oh, I had no idea. I mean, he'd been with me day in and day out for weeks. And he knew every single thing about this. And he was like, yeah, no, I had no idea, sir. He's nuts. Headley guy is crazy. He wants to spend $5 million. Okay, so fast forward, I don't know, 6 months, a year, and I had kind of gone from post to post, and I ended up being the director of the department that was manufacturing all these things. And in that time period, David Miscavige himself dictated how we were going to set all this stuff up. So it went from my project to his project.
So suddenly he's an expert in manufacturing.
Now he is going to figure out how to do this. And months had gone by. So by the time we actually ended up implementing and setting up all the equipment and all the procedures and all the staff and everything, probably half the time had gone by. So we had half as much time to do it. And so essentially, and this is sort of this is all leading up to me getting the shit kicked out of me by Miscavige, because he's walking through this area after we've set up all this new equipment and put all this stuff in and renovated the building and done it, all this stuff. Well, he spent $10 million. So he's walking through the building with me and tells me, now this is how you set it up. And sort of under my breath, but enough so that he could hear it, I go, well, yeah, if you have half as much time, you're going to spend twice as much money. And he lost it. He literally lost it. He started punching me out and shoving me against the wall. And I had glasses at the time. My glasses were busted. They were on the floor. And And I didn't fall down, but I kind of fell into this cabinet, this kind of wall unit, desk sort of thingy job. And I kind of retained my composure, and I looked at him, and I was like, you just punched me. And I was like, that's it. It's on. And as soon as the thought ran through my brain, he said, grab him. And literally a few guys grabbed me, and they just escorted me out the building. And when I was on my way out, I heard Miscavige say, did you see that? That guy was going to come at me and punch me. And I said that so that I knew he could hear it. You betcha I was, you're damn right. And he sent someone off to apologize to me later and said that he had come from some bad meeting or, whatever the mea culpa, quote unquote, was. But basically at that point, it was sort of like I just got physically assaulted by the guy who basically runs this whole place. And I knew from that point on, it probably wasn't going to work out. So I think that was maybe a year or so after that. I was done.
Mark, that was shocking. I'd like to pick this up on another episode of Surviving Scientology Radio. Love to have you back as our guest. And you've done so many things. I want to go over musical chairs on the next show.
Okay, that sounds good.
And really the process of disaffection. The book is called Blown for Good, Behind the Iron Curtain of Scientology. It's available at Amazon or at blownforgood.com. For Surviving Scientology Radio, this is Jeffrey Augustine. Thank you for listening. And as always, we will be in very good touch.